ready to add some sound effects to our game. I was just kidding about the earplugs, but I do want to warn teachers that if you're learning this in a classroom, it's going to be a little noisy. To minimize migraines, let's have everyone turn the volumes down on the computers to maybe 50% or so. Or better yet, use headphones. So playing sound effects in Scratch isn't quite as simple as you'd think. I showed you earlier that sound is controlled by these pink blocks. The two most important blocks are this one called Start Sound, and this one called Play Sound Until Done. Both blocks have a little options menu that will let you choose what sound to play, but when I pull it down, there are only two choices. I can make a pop sound, or I can record something new with my microphone. I'm not going to teach you about recording today, but feel free to experiment with this very cool feature. For now, though, let's stick with Scratch's built-in sounds. So how do we load new sounds into this menu so we can make it do something other than pop? Let's start by navigating over to the tabs at the top of your screen. We've already looked at the coding tab and the costumes tab. The last of these three tabs is called sounds, and that's the one we're interested in. Click here to load the Scratch sound editor, where you can select and modify new sounds for your game. Let's go ahead and load a new sound by hovering over this blue speaker-shaped button at the bottom left of the screen. This looks a lot like your options for choosing sprites, except the choices are choose a sound, record a sound, pick a random sound, and upload a sound you got from another source. Let's click on the magnifying glass to load up sounds from Scratch's built-in library. Here you'll find hundreds of sound effects and music files. Just like with your sprites, your sounds are all grouped into categories, and you can click any of these to filter your list, or just type something to the search window if you already know what you're looking for. You can preview a sound by hovering your mouse over the little play button at the top right of the file. I filtered for animal sounds here, so if your classroom isn't already a zoo, that's about to change. I'm looking for an eating sound here, so I'm going to type chomp into the search window to find it quickly. Once you find the sound you're looking for, all you have to do is click on it to load it into the sound editor. This is the part of the lesson where everyone stops listening to me and starts playing with sound effects. I'm okay with that, but you might want to pause the video for a minute until you get it out of your system. Once your sound is loaded into the audio editor, there are some buttons down here that you can use to modify your sound. There are options here to slow a sound down, speed it up, reverse it, and more. I'm pretty happy with my chomp sound the way that it is, so let's head back to the code tab and keep working. Now, when I hold down the options triangle on my start sound block, you can see that the chomp sound is one of the menu items I can pick. Every time this block is activated, it will make a chomp sound. So where exactly do we put this block? Like the score, this sound effect is something we want to trigger at the exact moment when the cat eats a mouse. Grab a start sound block and put it into the if statement. Let's test our game, and you can see that we get a nice, satisfying chomp sound now every time we eat a mouse. If you don't like the chomp sound, feel free to pick your own sound or record a new one. So you can see how this game is already 100% better with just a little bit of audio. In a minute, we're going to go back to the sound library and load some background music. But first, there are a few more things I need to show you about playing music files. If you're looking for cool background tracks, there's a special blue category button here in the sound library called Loops that will be very helpful. A loop is just a short piece of music that ends in the same spot where it began. You can repeat loops over and over, and they sound like one long song. You'll find all kinds of different music loops in Scratch's library, from classical and jazz to reggae and even beatboxing. This is a spot where things can get a little tricky if you don't understand the difference between starting a sound and playing it until done. The start sound block, which is the one we use for most video game sound effects, starts playing a sound and then immediately jumps to the next block. If our sprite is in a loop, like this ballerina, that can cause problems. The music starts playing, but since we're in a loop, it immediately swings around and goes back to its first instruction, restarting the audio. The song never gets a chance to play because it's constantly jumping back to the beginning. The play sound until done block solves that problem, kind of. As the name suggests, this block pauses the code blocks until the music is done playing. But now we have a whole new problem. The loop pauses to play the music, but while the music is playing, the rest of the code is frozen. The ballerina only moves once every 5 seconds or so after the song is finished playing. So the play sound until done block looks like the right one for playing background music in a loop, but we have to find a way to stop it from interfering with the animation. To solve this problem, we have to split the animation and the music into separate parts of the program so they don't interfere with each other. Computers are fast enough that they can do more than one thing at the same time. So what we can do here is separate out the music track and put it into its own little loop that runs at the same time as the animation loop. And now everything's working much more smoothly. So now that we understand how background music works, let's get back to our main program and set up a separate stack of code for background music. Put down a second green flag and a forever, and inside there we can add our background track. You can even add a second background track here, and they'll take turns playing. Awesome! Okay, our game is almost finished, but how will we know that we're actually done playing? Next up, we're going to look at how to end our game.